Hi, good morning, Excellency, Your Excellencies, all of you. It's a pleasure to be here this morning. I'm particularly delighted to be here with Tony Salame of the Aishdi Foundation in Beirut and Alina Konturi of the Neon Foundation in Athens. These are two of some of the most dynamic and creative cities that I've been to in recent years. I have to say, I have a soft spot for cities that are a little bit chaotic in climates where bougainvillea thrives. So I feel I'm uniquely suited to moderate this panel. I wanted to begin by asking both of you a little bit just about what your foundations do and the context in each of these cities in which they have come to be created. Aishdi was founded a little while ago, but you, Tony, just at the end of October opened a hugely impressive building with the art collection that you've amassed in recent years. I was present at the opening. It was a really remarkable event. If you haven't heard of Tony Salame as an art collector before, you will have heard of him now. And let's begin by just asking you a little bit about what is the Aishdi Foundation, and tell us all a little bit about, you know, the context in Beirut in which it came to be created and to open this fall.
You know, I'm Lebanese, and I was raised in a city which was ravaged by war. So when I was a student, I had always a dream to contribute in a way to restore the heritage or to be able to create a venue where people would have at least a hope of staying. All my friends were leaving the country, so I stayed there. I studied in Beirut. I went only for 2-3 years abroad. And always my dream was, in a way, to contribute one day, to give back to the city and to work in a nice environment. So we can see in some of the pictures, Beirut was in the 60s and the 70s, if we can consider the Paris of the Middle East. And we witnessed as kids Beirut destruction. So you can see how it was destroyed. And in one of those images, there is the street where I started my activity as a retailer. Not I started, where I believed in the downtown. And I restored those streets where I implemented many brands and luxury brands and the multi-brand Aishdi store. And this is when I felt, during that period, the first contribution I've done it was to restore the local, the Heritage National Museum of Beirut. And I was young then, so it was like the first check I ever done, but I felt that it's a responsibility. So when we restored the stores in downtown Beirut and the buildings, I felt that something was lacking. So we started adding some of the artworks of the collection to the street and to the stores. This is where I felt that many Lebanese, you can see, connected to those artworks, to the international contemporary scene, but they wanted more. So before opening the foundation, because we were collecting for the foundation, we felt that we can have, my wife and me, a space where we can invite galleries. So we restored an old Lebanese house, and we invited many galleries so people could interact and see what's going on the global art scene. Till the moment that 3 years ago that we decided to open the foundation. And this is where we chose David Ajay after many competitions with many architects, because David lived in Beirut. And even though we wanted to build that new space where we have a new experience where art and architecture could add to the fashion experience, because at the end of the day, we're fashion retailers. But respecting, in a way, the DNA. So David, as he lived in Beirut, he came up, and you'll see with the foundation design, he came up with the musharrabiyya in a new way. So he've created a new skin to the building. Inspired by the red color, which was the rooftops of all the Beirut buildings in that period. And so it's a new experience where social spaces like restaurant, this is the design and sketch of David, where social spaces like restaurant, shops, spa, could interact with art. So the art is, in a way, more exposed and not, it's more democratized in a way. And this was the Musharrabiyya design. So at the beginning, the intention was to do two separate buildings. He reunited them with the skin. And this is the first time where we can see, in a way, people enjoying the experience of art or food or fashion on the beach.
And this was, it's a little bit challenging to create something so big in a city like Beirut, which has problems with the electricity grid, which is a really complicated environment in which to operate. I wanted to ask Alina a little bit now to talk about what the Neon Foundation is, and then we'll come back to some of the challenges that I imagine both of these things have faced in coming to be.
Neon is a privately funded foundation. It's founded by Dimitris Daskalopoulos. And it's interesting because we decided to launch in 2012, started thinking about it, we launched in 2013. So this means that Greece was already into the fourth or fifth year of a deep recession, and now with official rates of unemployment about 20 to 25%. So the main question was, how do you make an institution that is relevant at these times, how you can make a contemporary art institution that can be a tool for growth, a tool for development, and to be relevant to the society in terms of giving experiences of pleasure, of alleviating some kind of stress, and also supporting the artistic community of Greece. So we launched Neon in 2013 with the main characteristic that it doesn't have physical space. Our space is the city, and we believe that art happens in the city. So our whole program that ranges from exhibitions to education, talks and events are all part of the city, or it's part of the public life. Mm-hmm. And we want to connect the idea of the citizen with the artwork and its daily routine and life. So in terms of our exhibition and the way we plan and program, we talked a lot yesterday about the idea of the heritage. And Greece and Athens is a very classical city. The moment you walk through it, it's everywhere distinctive, even visually, the classical past. So in order to complete our mission, which is to bring contemporary art closer to everyone, and by everyone, we define everyone as the uninitiated public, the one who might be afraid to enter a museum, the one who doesn't have any idea about what contemporary art is, or could even mock contemporary art. What are these objects? What are you doing this? We found a way to visually connect our classical past with contemporary art. So we have a city project every year that is dedicated to an archaeological space with new commissions by Greek artists. This is one way of putting temporary exhibitions into the public sphere. And when I talk about art, it's always on the form of temporary exhibitions. So it's either a group show or a solo show, but it's always a temporary exhibition. It's not a permanent public statue somewhere in the city. And the second aspect is we're trying to find hidden treasures within the city, which are were private, like private libraries. We had beautiful gardens, and we're only open to researchers. So we collaborated with the Whitechapel Gallery and opened two, the first year, the American School of the American Studies, with an exhibition which was open to the public. Suddenly the library, the United Library, became open for everyone to attend, and it's free of charge. And the second year was with the archaeological school, the French school. Mm-hmm. And what is interesting is if you give these opportunities to the public of entering a public space that was there always within their city, and they didn't know it existed, but can relate to them to it through the art. It's a new way of experience art, but also it's a new way of experiencing their own city. And especially during the summer, with what was going on in Athens and Greece and the referendum and the stress, are we going to stay in the euro? Are we going to leave the European Union? The dynamics between the citizens were very hard for after so many years. We had like a divide in the society. To create places of tranquility, like we see in the photos now, or of leisure, it helped people unwind, and people used to come even more, and they had a need for this even more.
I think that's a really important thing in Athens. We were speaking yesterday, and I realized that Dimitris Daskalopoulos, the businessman who started Neon, he was the head of the business association in Athens, and I had interviewed him in 2011. He was very direct in talking about the challenges that Greece was facing. I believe at that point he said that Greece was a guinea pig for Europe experimenting on it, and he said usually in the end the guinea pig dies. I guess that this is a way to help the guinea pig through these difficult times. Your approach of building with the collection that you've amassed over several years, the approach of Neon to not have a space but to interact with the city, I wonder if you could each talk a little bit about how these projects, which are private initiatives, were received in cities where, unlike a place like Paris or cities where there's a lot of kind of cultural infrastructure, government infrastructure, you kind of had to go at this on your own. And I just wonder what the perceptions were of how was Aishti received both by the political establishment and by people in Beirut and then later on for Neon as well. Tony?
You know, Beirut has a very active artistic scene. We have many international artists who live in Beirut or abroad, many institutions like Ashkal Alwan, Beirut Art Center. They just restored the museum, Sursuk Museum. So first of all, people are used to it, but they're not exposed to what's going or what's happening outside. So in our case, as we tried in other venues, it was a bit difficult. So we wanted to have our own venue where we could create a platform, starting having showing some international artists and Lebanese artists and showing this dialogue between the cultures. So it was a natural choice to have our own space because, you know, you can plan and program in advance in a city like Beirut, where instability is key, where there is no electricity. So we've witnessed that for the last, 30 years. And the most challenging thing is today to be able to share the collection and continue our project in a very unstable environment where ISIS is 2 hours away by car. And you were talking about Palmyra, it's 2 hours from the city of Beirut. And this is the biggest challenge. While politically in Beirut, we've been used to what's going on, unfortunately, and we don't have a choice. We have to continue looking into the future and trying to ameliorate or enhance the everyday life with art.
Do you feel like Aishti was received well locally, or was there kind of a sense of skepticism by some people when you know, because there isn't, you know, it's a complicated city in which to operate, in which private initiative operates, but then there's kind of, who, you know, what is this, and how do you think it was received?
You know, it was a new venue and a new experience for the Lebanese, so they never had this interaction before, and maybe because it's coming from a private initiative, but the reaction was great over the past months, where people are visiting on daily basis. Every time I see people visiting, they thank me to share with them the collection and to bring what's going on in the international contemporary art scene to Beirut. So I think the reaction was good at the end of the day.
No, it's true. I mean, it brings contemporary art to a city that hasn't had so much international contemporary art on view before, and you're going to rotate the collection in the coming months, as I understand it. Massimiliano Gioni did the exhibit. Yeah. Elena, for Neon in Athens, in this very complicated social and political environment in which this foundation came into being, doing works that want to engage the people in Athens and to ask questions about what is the public space. These are questions that have been asked in Athens since at least the time of Antigone. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how Neon was received, and were people skeptical about it? What, or did people just not quite know what it was, or were they waiting for it?
I don't think they were waiting for it, no. At the beginning, it was a surprise. A lot of people were skeptical. The first questions were, why spend money on art? Why spend money on culture when there are so many other needs? So this is the first question. The other is, why does a private collector wants to spend this way and be involved in the civic life is there an ulterior motive? So we had to challenge this as well through our program. And the third one, which was very from the start, it was an initial resistance of why to put art in the public space, why to organize a temporary exhibition. So we had to work quite slowly on building that. And actually, you build up your strength and you create a community only by results, only by showing your work and getting the trust and the acceptance because you're doing something that it has a value for the public.
Why?
But the first reactions were, I remember my first idea or the first project was to have contemporary art in our national garden together with a plan, a landscape designer, Louis Benesch, to make a design for the garden. And this led to the friends of the garden taking us to court for an injunction not to do it. So, but since then, 3 years after we have shown our intentions, the level of the program, how the public has reacted, we won the court case. It's not relevant anymore, and but it's relevant in the sense that now there's a large informed society about what you can do with the arts, and that a garden can play a place to be used for cultural activities. So this was the ruling. So I think through times and resistance into something, a change occurs, even if, you know, you have to fight for it.
Why was there resistance to doing public or doing art in a public garden? Because it was a public space and you were a private institution, or because there was just a certain amount of mistrust? Who are these people? What are they doing?
I think both. Yes, it was a new institution. It was the first idea. The National Garden, it's national, and it felt like, why give the garden to this organization, and how did they come about thinking about it? So I think it ignited a lot of attention, but it opened up the debate a lot of how you use the public space. Because in Athens at the time, we had images of using the public space with for activism, for really fighting for the rights, for complaining about pension cuts, the government, and this was another form of showing resistance within the city through the visual arts, through beauty, through another different experience with the city and the artwork. So
it's true, in recent years, Athens has been very much a highly volatile place, and there have been so many demonstrations where there is a performative aspect to many of these political demonstrations, it seems. You now have a project on where Marina Abramović has been working with different Greek artists to do performance pieces. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about that and about, the context in which these performances have come about? This is on in Athens at Neon at the moment.
Okay. What I consider like a strength of our organization is like 60% of our activities are focused on commissioning new work. So with this project, it's about the long durational performance. And there was an open call of 300 applications came in, and we were down to 50 and then down to 29 artists. So there are 29 artists performing long duration performance. This means from a day, 8 hours nonstop, to 7 weeks. So six artists are 7 weeks every day, in total 324 hours. And it's a project about the material art and live art. So Marina is there as a teacher for these artists. And she also shows her method on the ground floor of a museum.
Mm. You were showing me yesterday a picture that one of the artists involved in this is sitting on the top of a building. And how did the neighbors respond?
Oh, that was another small. He's sitting on the opposite building of the Benaki Museum because he was trying to get over his. The performance is all about getting over his fear of heights. So he sits in a 60-meter building. He's tied up at the back, but the people were calling the police that somebody's about to jump. So the police came, had to sign a release form that he's fine. It's a part of an art project. So this is things that happen when you're in the city and you want to do performance art, it happens.
It also says something, I think, about just the sense of anxiety and instability in Athens. I wonder
but if... But in another country, it might not have been realized as well. You might have never gotten the permission or the okay to do that.
That's probably true. There are lawsuits about some things in Greece, but not about other things. I want to ask both of you a little bit. Do you think that the fact that both of your cities, Beirut and Athens, have a certain amount, if not a great amount, of political and social instability, do you think that that contributes to the creative life of those cities, Tony?
I think so, because people has to find a way to express themselves. So when in the artistic scene in Beirut, many of the artists and the social community for the past 10, 20 years, we're always having works related to the war and the images of the war and what's going on. So they always question themselves, what's next, what's happening. This instability let them be more creative sometimes to find different ways to express their feelings. So it can contribute in a way, I think. But there is no institution to guide them to have more and more creative works.
It's a ground-up phenomenon.
Yeah.
Yeah. What about in Athens?
I think that it's two ways to look at it. The one is how national institutions are suffering. There's always been in society, there's always a debate, what's the value of a national opera, of a national museum, how much should we spend on it? And now this debate is even harsher on culture. So this is something that has affected a lot the way our museums operate, their long-term stability, their short-term sustainability. So this is a real issue, and which is the negative side of having the recession. The positive side you can have, if you have a positive side, is for that it's really a society that has stimulus at the moment. So for the artists, we have seen a lot of artists coming and living in Athens, also because Documenta is going to be hosted there next year. The subject that Documenta has, learning from Athens, has attracted a lot of attention to our city. It will definitely have a spillover effect for tourism and for the next 6 months and a year ahead. So for the artists that are there, and they're there, I don't know if they have they're taking all in. I don't know if they respond immediately, because you cannot really respond immediately. There's too much going on. But definitely doesn't leave them without an energy and actual questions about what is going on in society, because artists have to answer these questions. And I think it's one of the best places to be at the moment if you're an artist.
Because there are so many questions.
Yeah.
So when you were talking before, you mean that the state has no money, and so the question is, why should what limited state resources there are go towards things like opera and the arts? There's a lot of questioning of that going on right now. And at the same time, there's also skepticism of private initiatives stepping in to take that place, because again, what is the private sector doing in the public sector?
The private sector cannot replace the public sector. And I don't think that any private institution in Greece pioneers to take this role. A private institution can step in wherever it considers it's a vital part of their mission. Mm-hmm. But public institutions are suffering, yes.
That's for sure. Before we're even finished, I wonder if there are any questions from anybody in the audience. In the front row here.
Hello. Yeah. Good morning, and thank you for your presentation. I have a question for Elena. Excuse me. Could you explain a little bit the curation process and how you go about choosing what sort of artists and you?
We have a very open approach. So when I make the whole program, I collaborate either with institutions from abroad and curators that I invite. So I go vice versa. First of all, I choose the location or the place that I want to activate based on what is needed in society and what I think should be the group show or a solo show, and what are the commissioning artists, and then I invite the curator to work on that show, or I work with another institution on that. So it's every time it's a different process. In our projects, I am involved with the states, because when I need permission for the archaeological sites or any public site, there's a very meticulous situation that I have to go through. There has to be a research, a detailed plan. It has to go through the Archaeological Council of Greece, and you usually have to wait for a year to get approval. So you have to be really flexible. But this is my involvement with the states. It has to do with bureaucracy, but also if you hold an exhibition in one of their significant sites, the meanings have to coincide. So you have to take the research and the meaning from the site, and then the artist has to work around that. But in terms of funding, no, they're not involved. We are privately funded by our founder.
Are there any other audience questions? Michael.
Yes, first, thank you both for this wonderful presentation. A question for both Alina and Tony. How do you think about the balance between making the public aware of contemporary art and the role of art in society versus the importance of knowing the mission of your foundation and your center? How do you balance those two thoughts?
How do I balance our mission with the importance of contemporary art? In our case, it's quite linked, because my main mission is to bring contemporary art to the public. So my mission is to bring as much more people possible near the values, the stories, the artists that contemporary art can show. I don't see there being a conflict in this procedure.
How important is it to you that the public understand Neon Foundation,
okay, I see,
and what Neon Foundation is doing, and Ashti Center, yeah, and what Ashti Center is doing, versus experiencing the art?
It takes time to understand what we're doing, and it really helps if we have the educational program in the schools that we have, in the public schools, because our educational program is not, it's directed to the public schools of Greece, so we go in the public schools. And this has helped a lot to understand that contemporary art is about learning, and this is our mission as well. So to bridge the idea of how you value contemporary art and how a citizen can become to be, to value contemporary art, and how this is linked with the experience, the only thing is through education.
In my case, I don't know if there is an equilibrium or between our interest for art and the public perception, but I think already sharing what we have sharing a lot of very important artworks that we lived with the population or with the public, this is already a sign of willingness from our end. And we're doing a lot of programs with the schools, with the university, that they come and see what's going on. It's free of charge. We guide them through that whole process. And every time it's a project on its own, it's a book that we edit, we invite everyone to, in a way, to see what's going on. We explain to them to be part of the whole contemporary art scene. For sure, it's not an easy mission, because it's the beginning. People think that we're showing the artwork sometimes because we have an intention, commercial, or they criticize that there is a lack of some artist, maybe from the region. But it's a process, and we need to build it together, so with the public.
I want to thank both of you for an interesting conversation, but I have to say I was pleasantly surprised when I read about Ashti Foundation. I remember it was covered on the Financial Times, and I want to thank you for adding something like that to the region, because I think one of the things that we would love to see from a public point of view, government-funded institutions, is more activity from the private sector. And I think you set a new benchmark with the quality of you know, architect, but also collection and so forth. And it's interesting that you say one of the criticism is how to engage more local artists, because I think that's a common challenge in a way. How do we, as in the Arab world, bring our artists to the same level field of, you know, known artists in the West? So first, I want to thank you and congratulate you, but also, I don't know if there's any advice to the private sector where we can see more of such initiatives where there's really support for contemporary art, both of local artists and international artists. Thank you.
First of all, Your Highness, thank you for having us, and you're a great example of how you can, with public institution, give the guidance for the private sector. When I landed at the airport, I didn't come to Qatar for the last 3 years, and I saw the teddy bear. It gives you an idea which city you're coming in. And we're trying from our end, on our level, as privates, to create the scene. I think by having this conference, bringing Jeff Koons to see what's going on in Qatar, by seeing yesterday the Chinese artist curated by Shao, this gives even the local artist an open eye. The dialogue is there, so any local artist can be there in Qatar or in Beirut and see what's going on. So unfortunately, in the Middle East, all the Middle East, also what you're doing is very daring, even though we hear a lot of museums that they want to open, but nothing happened yet. There is no regulations for art. There is no regulations for foundation. And like, to get a piece of art is like getting a weapon sometimes. So it goes through processes that they're in Beirut. Sometimes they're crazy. I don't know here how, if you've done something for that. So you pay all the taxes, and it's always with suspicion. When they see an artwork, they want to see, examine it, sometimes touching it. So if you could help us, I think, in the region to really do programs that we can enter exchange between the countries, between the artists. I would like some Qatari artists to come and visit Beirut and do a project with the Lebanese artist. But at the same time, we should work together on some regulations to make this art easily shared within our region. And this is a great thing for the, especially for the youth, especially now. You know, when you see what's going on in the region of vandalism, destruction of all the monuments, historic monuments, I think we have a responsibility, all of us, to build architecturally landmarks, but to have art as an expression of freedom, and to open the barriers between all the Arab countries, because this would help people to understand more what's going on the international scene and to engage in this artistic platform. So thank you again. Thank you for having us.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid we don't have time for more questions, but it's been a pleasure to have both of you here. Thank you. We'll continue.
Thank you.
Thank you.